But this determinant is a determinant of a 2x2 matrix, and that 2x2 matrix is the one created from those four numbers. So one way to imagine it is that we start with A, so we cover up this column, we cover up this row, and then we would get EF, HI, that's the determinant we need here. So this is EF, HI. And that is a determinant that we just did a second ago, 2x2. So this becomes A, and then we do E times I minus H times F, and that's it. Okay, so that's the first step. The second step is that we're going to do the same thing for B. But what we'll do is instead of putting positive B here, we actually do the opposite. So we're going to go minus B and then times another determinant. Now this determinant, what we do is we imagine we've covered up B, so we cover up this column, we cover up this row, and we're left with the DF in the GI. I don't know if you can see that. Cover this up, cover that up. We have DF, GI. So I have DF here and GI. Now, of course, this is negative B, and then D times I minus G times F. All right, and then we continue. We have one more to do. So we take C, right? And what we're doing is we're alternating here. We have positive A, negative B, positive C, so plus C, and then another determinant here. This determinant, we cover up this column, cover up this row, D, E, G, H. D, E, G, H. So we get plus C times now the determinant DH minus GE. And then you could, if you wanted to, you could multiply the A through here, the negative B through here, the C through here, and that would be your determinant. So that's how you do a 3x3. So now let's go back. What's most important there is the method, okay? Now, also, that method extends out to 4x4, but I won't get into that. okay, so what is the capital J? Right, that's the question. What is that capital J whenever we are trying to do our change of variables? Well, capital J stands for what's called the Jacobian, sometimes referred to as the Jacobian determinant. And here's how it works. Since we're only going to be working with double and triple integrals, we're going to have one of two scenarios. We're either going to be changing x and y over to u and v, or if it's triple integral, we're going to change x, y, z over to, let's say, u, v, w. All right, so I'm going to look at each of these cases. So let's try the first case. What if we were trying to figure out what the Jacobian is when we were going from x, y over to u, v? So the Jacobian, the notation for it looks like this. That's the notation for the Jacobian, and here's what it is. It's the determinant, okay? And it's going to be, since we're two variables to two variables, this is going to be a 2x2 matrix. It is the partial of x with respect to u, partial of y with respect to u. Oh, sorry. Oops. Messed that up. Partial of x with respect to v, then partial y with respect to x, partial y with respect to v. So one way you could look at it is if you have two variables, x and y, so you're going to do partials of x across the top, the second row partials of y, and then You have U and V, so this one is with respect to U, then that one's with respect to V. This one with respect to U, and then this one with respect to V. All right, so now, what is that determinant? Well, that determinant is this times this, so partial X with respect to U times partial Y with respect to V minus this times this. I'm going to change the order. Partial X with respect to V times partial Y with respect to U. So that is the Jacobian of the transformation that takes X, Y over to U, V. Now remember, when you do that change of variables, your X will be some function of U, V, and your Y will be some function of U, V. That's what gives you the switch, the change. And that's what we're doing. These equations that we have here, that's what these partials are. So the partial of X with respect to U will be the partial of this equation with respect to U. Then the partial of X with respect to V is this equation, derivative with respect to V, and so on and so forth. So that's your Jacobian for a two-variable change. All right. Now, if you want to do the Jacobian for a three-variable change, then what we're going to have is this. So imagine we're taking X, Y, Z, and we're switching it over to U, V, W. So X is some function of U, V, W. Y is going to be some function. Sorry, I wrote this wrong. X is equal to some function of U, V, W. Y is equal to some function of U, V, and W. And Z is also some function of U, V, W. All right, so the Jacobian will be partial, we're switching X, Y, Z over partial U, V, W. So that's just, again, that's just notation. And this, by definition, is going to be, okay, so my first variable is X. So I'm going to have partial X, partial X, partial X, but then I'm going to go with respect to the three variables, U, V, W. Then I have another row, this time partials with respect to Y, or partial of Y with respect to the three variables, U, V, W. And then lastly, partial of Z with respect to the three variables, so U, V, W, the determinant of that. So what you could do now, I'm just going to set up the first part of this. It would be starting with this, partial X with respect to U times the determinant of this thing, right? Well, you know what? I'll go shorter. So that times this, so partial Y with respect to V times partial Z with respect to W, so that's this times this. And then minus partial of Y with respect to W times that partial Z with respect to V. And then I continue. I'm not going to do it all, but I would. The next one would be minus, and then this partial X with respect to V, and then I would have another determinant. So I'd have a total of three of those. And that would be how you change over with three variables. All right, so let me try and generalize this. Okay, suppose you have a function of X and Y, okay, and you're trying to do a double integral of this over the region R with respect to area. And you're going to make a change of variables. Your X is going to become X of U, V, and your Y is going to become some function of U and V also. Then this will be equal to the double integral over S. Now, S is the new region, right, that I showed you earlier, of F with the X replaced with the function, the Y replaced with its function of U and V. But then this next part is going to be the absolute value of the Jacobian, all right? And then du, dv, or possibly dv, du, depending on, again, what this new region looks like, what that new region S looks like. So remember this right here, the Jacobian is the partial x, y, partial uv. We showed that earlier. That's notation for the Jacobian. But then we want to take the absolute value of it. So remember, that's a determinant, right? But then whatever your answer is, you want to take the absolute value. So this is the formula whenever you have a switch from two variables to two new variables. Now, if we change this and we make this triple integral with respect to volume, then my x is going to become a function of uv and w, my y is going to be uv and w, and now I have my z is also a function of uv and w. And now this becomes this. I need a w in here. I need a w in here. So my x gets switched over to the new function of three variables, my y gets switched over to the function of the three new variables, my z gets switched over to the function of three new variables, and then I have my absolute value of my Jacobian, and then this will either be like du, dv, dw, or maybe it's du, dw, dv, or maybe it's dv, du, dw, and there's a few more combinations. But the important thing is that this right here is that Jacobian determinant, whatever that is, that's a determinant, and then the absolute value of that. Okay, so what I'm going to do now is I'm going to do a few examples. And the first example I'm going to do, is the double integral over the region D of 4x plus 8y dA, where D is this parallelogram. It has the point, let's see, negative 1, 3. That's the point, negative 1, 3. It has the point 1, negative 3. It has the point 3, negative 1. And 1, 5. So it's the parallelogram formed by those four points. So let me see. I believe this is going to go down like this. It's going to go down like this, across like that. Okay, there's my parallelogram. That's my D. And we want to do this double integral, but here's the change of variables, okay? We're going to make x be equal to 1/4 u plus v. We're going to make y be equal to 1/4 and then v minus 3u. Now, I want to be very clear about something. This transformation, okay, this change of variables is being given to us, all right? This is given. In general, nobody's ever going to give you that change of variables. So a question we'll answer later is, what if you're not given that? How are you going to come up with the change of variables that's going to work? I also want you to notice that x here is a function of u and v, and y here is a function of u and v also. So this is my x is now some function of u and v. And this is now my y here is some function of u and v. All right, going back over here, we want to know, you know, where does this region go? What does it turn into over here in this new transformation into the uv plane? So what I could do is I could pick a point and I could say, where does that point go? That would take forever though, because I have an infinite number of points. So instead what I'm going to do is I'm going to look at these line segments, okay, for my parallelogram. I'm going to see where they go under the transformation. So my first line segment that I'm going to work with is this one right here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and find the equation of that line segment. So notice that this is a line, right? And so I can find the equation of a line various ways. Notice that my slope, I come down 1, 2, 3, and over 1. So I have a slope. I can say that that line has equation y equals negative 3x. I know that so far. And it appears to have a y-intercept of 0. So I can say plus 0. That is this green line. Now, if you have 2 points on a line, you can always find the equation doing a more rigorous computation. But just visually, I can tell that's what the equation is. I know that that's what the y-intercept is, so I feel good about that. So my question is, where does that line go under that those transformations? So I'm going to come over here, and I'm going to take this equation, y equals negative 3x. And I'm going to replace y with this, and I'm going to replace x with this. So let's see what happens. This left side becomes 1/4 v minus 3u, and that equals negative 3 times x, but x is 1/4 times u plus v. And I noticed that because this is multiplication, I have a 1/4 here and a 1/4 here. I'm just going to multiply both sides by 4. That'll give me v minus 3u equals, it'll kill off this 1/4, so I'll still have the negative 3 out here. And then I'm going to distribute it through here. So I'm going to distribute that negative 3 through. So negative 3u minus 3v. Okay, well, what is that? Notice that I have negative 3u and negative 3u, that if I add 3u on both sides, they cancel. So I'm left with v equals negative 3v. And if I add 3v to both sides, I'll get 4v equals 0. And divide by 4, I get v is 0. So what this tells me is that this line segment here under the transformation given is going to turn out to be v equals 0. Well, v equals 0 is like the equation of a line. V is my, kind of like the y-axis was over there. So v being 0 corresponds to this line over here, which is like the u-axis. Okay, that's the first transformation. Now let me go over here and try and find where, let's see where this one goes. Okay, so for that one, I think I'm going to spend a little more time coming up with the equation of that. And that's just because I want you to want to make sure you know how to do the computation. So if we're given 2 points, right? We can find the slope of the line using y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1. I'm going to say this is x2, y2, this is x1, y1. So if I do negative 1 minus 5 over, okay, 3 minus 1, I get negative 6 over 2, which is negative 3. So the slope of that line segment is negative 3, and then I use this formula, y minus y1 equals m times x minus x1. This was what was called the point-slope form of a line. I know m, I know x1 and y1, so this is going to become y minus y1 is minus 5 equals m, which is negative 3, and then x minus x1 is 1. So this is y minus 5 equals negative 3x plus 3, distributing through. And then you get y equals negative 3x plus 8. Now, I could have determined that myself. I could have said, okay, well, this has the same